Welcome to another episode of the Gunblog Variety Cast with your hosts, Sean Sorrentino and Aaron Paulette.
Welcome to episode 163 of Gunblog Variety Cast Radio, a proud member of the Self-Defense Radio Network. How are you doing, Aaron?
I am good but anxious. I'm getting ready for AMCON and GRPC later this week.
All right. So by the time this comes out, those will both be over. So we can expect you to be telling us next week about how awesome it was.
Exactly. Now, for people who are going, huh, what's AMCON? AMCON is the Alternate Mass Media Conference, and that's being hosted by Paul Lathrop and the Polite Society podcast, and also by the Self-Defense Radio Network, if I understand correctly. It is being billed as a workshop for podcasters, bloggers, YouTube creators, and anyone else in new media that has a connection to the Second Amendment community. And so it sounds like it's just going to be, here's how to leverage your podcast, your blog, whatever, in order to reach more people. And that's going to be interesting. And, you know, Paul is a great guy. I'm looking forward to seeing what sort of conference he's cooked up.
Awesome. So I can expect that you're going to be talking with everybody there about how they need to be listening to you on this podcast. And we're going to pick up a bunch of new listeners, right?
Yes. Yes. I'm going to talk about how awesome I am.
I don't care why they're listening. I don't care if they think I'm a turd, as long as they're listening. I don't care if they're like, I don't like that Sean dude, but I'm here for Aaron. Hey, ears, man. I want them here. I'm expecting there's going to be lots and lots of people who want to advertise on the podcast too, right?
Well, I'm not sure about that. I think this is mostly for the content generators, but I will ask.
Because we can always use people who want to advertise on the podcast. Keep that in mind, listeners, if you know somebody who'd like to advertise on the podcast.
So AMCON runs all day Friday, and it breaks just in time for the GRPC mixer, where I have been invited to participate in a concealed carry fashion show hosted by my friend and fellow podcaster Amanda Suffacool. So I have some mixed feelings about this. I am definitely flattered to have been invited, but I am nervous because I don't think of myself as particularly fashionable or as a good model. But she's my friend and she asked me and I'm going
to
do it.
You're going to need to spend the rest of the day binge watching one of those that Project Runway or something like that so you can learn how to walk.
I need to channel my inner Tim Gunn and make it work.
Yeah, that's the dude who showed him how to walk, right?
I think so. I don't watch that show.
I think I've seen enough of it for my wife to say that dude can walk.
And then there's GRPC itself, which is Saturday and Sunday, and my panel, which is called Growing Gun Rights in the LGBT Community. I didn't spell it. That's how they have it. Is scheduled to run from 10:45 to 11:15 on Sunday. And I'm going to be speaking after Nikki Stallard of the Pink Pistols. She says she's going to try and quit early. I don't know if that's going to happen. I also know from last year that a lot of the panels run longer than the organizers want. So 11-ish for me to speak is not really set in stone. It's, as Captain Barbossa said, it's more of a guideline, really.
And you can't really blame them for LGBT because you guys keep changing the acronym around, so, I mean, like, whatever.
Oh,
you know what they meant.
Oh, yeah, I know. The current all-inclusive thing sounds like a cheerleader cheer.
Oh, dear God. No, stop. I think you're right. Just call it the queer community and leave it at that.
Exactly. We're reclaiming the name.
Eh, whatevs.
All right,
you know
Mr.
What?
Cheerful.
At a certain point, everybody just says, you know what? Figure it out. I don't care. We know who we're talking about, and if you know we're talking about you, that's good enough.
Yeah, I agree. How about you, Mr. Sunshine? What's going on in your life?
Well, it's been an interesting week. I spent all of last week, I think I told you already, I was in Philadelphia. I was there for training on a new company computer. In the course of the inspections that I do for the insurance company that I work for, I go from place to place and I do inspections. Well, for 10 years, I've done it on a clipboard and pieces of paper. And I'd write down all the information that I needed to know. And I would take that piece of paper home and I would sit in front of my computer and I would type all this information in.
Oh, are they going paperless and giving you a tablet?
In fact, they gave me a tablet and I can type in the data on the tablet. Now, there's some problems with that because whoever programmed Windows 10 was a moron. And not in the way that everybody thinks. Like, oh, Windows 10 is a piece of junk. Windows 10 works fine. Get off them about that. The problem is the person who programmed the virtual keyboards that pop up on your touchscreen obviously never looked at an actual keyboard, because the 10 key, you know, the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, the number lock, the plus, minus, all that stuff, that's a 10 key. It comes from the adding machines that people used to use. If you've ever looked at them on your keyboard and then open up your phone and look at the touchpad on that, you'll see that the 10 key is opposite the phone. And anybody who has practiced, and trust me, when you do the kind of data entry I do, I've practiced on a 10 key, the phone's backwards. Well, whoever programmed it in Windows 10 programmed it backwards like a telephone instead of properly like a 10 key. Ugh, it's irritating. And you're like switching screens back and forth in order to use this keyboard and that keyboard, and the comma is on the letters and not with the numbers, so you can't type in thousands comma, you know, 1,000,000 for a million without switching screens back and forth.
Oh, what a pain.
So that's the problem. There's nothing wrong with the system that we're using. It's great. I love it. I do almost all of my work in the field now. I come home, I plug my computer in, I do one or two things that can only be done by, you know, when I get home, and then I chuck it up on the shelf and I'm done. It's awesome.
Have you considered getting a stylus?
It's got a stylus. The stylus is almost as hard to use as anything else that that thing does.
What?
Part of it is just, you know, I don't know how to use it quite right yet. You know, there's a lot of learning curve involved, and I'm sure I'll get better at it. And part of it is tablets are not really designed for generation of content. They're designed for consumption of content. You use a real keyboard and a real screen to type a book. You don't type your book on a virtual screen. It just doesn't work.
Well, yeah, I understand that. I just figured because you were so used to using the pen and clipboard method that a stylus and tablet would have that same basic functionality.
It does. It does. Let me tell you, if you've never used a PDF annotator where you can take this PDF with all the stuff written on it and then written on it, just like flat out, whatever color you want, markers, shapes, dyes, what, doesn't matter. Just start writing on it and it saves it. It's freaking cool. The problem is that doesn't change my workflow any. Why would I duplicate the work that I'm doing on an electronic form with a $2,000 tablet that I can do the same thing with a pen and paper? You know, there's a lot of neat apps that you could use that are actually easier to write down in a little notebook and put in your pocket. So basically what I would be doing is I would be crawling really fast. Little babies, when it comes time to learn to walk, they'll walk, but if they really need to move somewhere, they'll drop back down and crawl really fast because they can crawl faster. What I really need to do is I need to do the workflow in the new way. I need to get over the learning curve. Maybe some of it will go away as I get more experience because I've had it in the field for like 3 days now. But other than that, it's pretty cool. I'm really liking that. And at the same time, Thursday, I came home. I didn't do any work in the field. I, you know, just flew home and then I did the podcast. Friday, I went out in the field with the computer for the first time. And when I got done with my work Friday, I went and I traded in the company car for a new car, which is the same car as the old car. It's just the 2018 version of the Camry Hybrid. And oh my goodness, I love my new car. So it's been pretty cool. I've had a good week.
All right, then.
There'll be more on the car later in the plug of the week section. So it's coming up on it. We are right on top of October the 1st. So on October 1st, I'm going to randomly select one person who is a member of GBVC Radio Group on Facebook, and I'm going to give you a cat tourniquet, the little belt pouch that it comes in, and also, courtesy of Filster, a Filster flat pack so you can pack that thing right on your belt. You've got the flat pack, I've got a flat pack, we both like them, and the cat tourniquet is one of two tourniquets that you can buy that is actually approved by the Committee on Tactical Combat Casualty Care. The other one is the soft T-wide, so you're getting a top-line tourniquet, you're getting a great way to carry it, and an extra pouch in case maybe you want to put it in that. All you have to do is be a member of GBVC Radio Group, so search GBVC Radio on Facebook and join the group. October 1st is coming up fast. It's only a couple of days after this podcast drops, so next week when we do this podcast, we'll be announcing the winner.
Thanks to Lucky Gunner and Remington for their support of Gunblog Varietycast Radio. From Golden Saber to Range Rounds, get a full lineup of quality Remington ammo that ships fast at LuckyGunner.com.
All right, let's get on with the show.
What happens when more than 350 gun-toting ladies get together? Beth travels to Utah to attend a conference for the well-armed woman to find out.
Well, as per the norm, I am once again traveling, this time in Provo, Utah, with the National Leadership Conference of the Well-Armed Woman. So what exactly happens when you get 350-plus well-armed women together for a fun-filled, action-packed weekend? Well, a lot of stuff happens. There are all sorts of networking events, range time, seminars, and of course opportunities for us to get to know one another a little bit better and hopefully help one another out in our journeys educating, empowering, and equipping women, especially within our industry. On Thursday, I had the opportunity to work with some of my fellow USCCA team members as we helped with one of the sessions at Range Day. It was an incredibly beautiful range with just the mountains all around us. Gorgeous weather. It couldn't be more perfect with a little bit of sunshine, a small breeze, and just an absolute ideal temperature right around, I think, 65 or 66 degrees. And we had the opportunity to see roughly 100 of the ladies as they came through our session about range management and range control. It's always so awesome to watch the light bulbs go off, to see the camaraderie between all the ladies, and of course, to learn from one another. I always like to say that even though I teach the class several times, there's always something new that I get out of it. And of course, even as a student taking classes even over and over again, I feel like I'm always learning something new, something different, or maybe a unique way to think about things. Even taking the same classes from different instructors will give you an opportunity to have a fresh perspective, a new perspective, a different perspective, or of course, in some cases, it might teach you what you really would like to do or might want to incorporate in your own classes, in your own training, or whatnot, or it might show you what doesn't work for you, which is not necessarily a bad thing. Maybe it's a teaching style that doesn't work, or maybe it's some kind of firearm handling technique that just isn't quite right for you, your skill level, your abilities, or your preferences. The remainder of the weekend for the well-armed women includes banquets, awards, dinners, lots of different sessions from people like the NSSF, and of course, the founder herself, Carrie Lightfoot, and even some inspirational messages from ladies like Antonia Okafor and Gabby Franco and Kim Corbin, from many different backgrounds, experiences, and walks of life, but still whose mission it is to make a difference in the lives of women, especially to get them encouraged, to get them trained, to get them comfortable and confident with firearms, especially in the area of being personal protectors for themselves and, of course, their families. Some of the sponsors of this year's National Leadership Conference include Ruger and Glock, Walther, Liberty Safe, LWRC International, Hornady, Taser, Girls with Guns, Gun Totin' Mamas, UTM, Action Target, Crossbreed Holsters, Yellow Jacket, Laser Ammo, Tactical Wall, Sticky Holsters, the NSSF, Freedom Munitions, Gunsight, and of course the USCCA. So a whole host of organizations, manufacturers, and groups that provide different products and services for anyone in the industry. It's awesome to see them supporting different activities and organizations that are specific for women and keeping women's needs in mind, especially when they're producing different products and services as well. This, for me, is the third conference that I've attended, and it's always just such a great experience. I think women have learned that we learn well from one another, that we can encourage and build one another up, and that even we can have some friendly competition or come together and work together on a common goal and a common cause. There are over 320 chapters currently in 49 states, so it's definitely something that you should check out in your local area, whether you want to join the group, whether you would like to somehow contribute to the organization, whether it's a donation of your time or products or money. I know they're always looking for people who can help with range safety officer duties. And of course, we do invite a lot of instructors and outside speakers to come in and share their expertise with ladies who are learning about everything from situational awareness to even some of the basics that you would need for first aid. So definitely check out the Well-Armed Woman in your area or other organizations that cater specifically to getting women together to shoot and learn. And until next time, stay safe and be well-armed.
You can read more from Beth at usconcealedcarry.com/blog and click on Pacifiers and Peacemakers in the left sidebar.
This podcast runs on your donations. Go to gunblogvarietycast.com and click on the donate or the subscribe button in the right sidebar. You can make a one-time donation of any amount or subscribe for as little as $2 a month. That doesn't sound like much, but we pay our server costs monthly, and a little help from you is a big help to us.
Felons behaving badly. Man shot by police after holding pregnant woman hostage. It's all right for me to use my happy voice for this one, right, Aaron?
Yes, absolutely. Well, I don't know. Was she hurt?
No, she's fine.
Oh, yes. Well, in that case, happy voice.
Investigations are taking place after an officer-involved shooting, during which the suspect was holding a pregnant woman hostage. The incident occurred in North Charlotte on Monday night around 10 p.m. Officers were called to a home on the 1900 block of Holly Street after a break-in was reported at the residence. According to police, the suspect, 28-year-old Suspect 1, approached the home with another suspect and demanded money from the pregnant victim. Suspect 1 mentioned the name of the victim's husband while threatening her, leading police to believe the attack was not random. When police arrived on scene, the second suspect, described as a heavy-set black man in dark clothes, ran from the scene while Suspect 1 came out of the house holding the pregnant woman at gunpoint. Officers on the scene demanded that he drop his weapon. When the suspect refused, officers perceived an imminent threat and fired their weapons at the suspect. The suspect was struck several times, once in the stomach, and Suspect 1 was taken to the hospital where he had surgery and remains in critical condition. The woman, her unborn child, and a child who was also in the home during the incident were all unharmed. Reports indicate that the woman was taken to a hospital as a precautionary measure. In addition to three outstanding warrants from a county outside of Mecklenburg County for driving with a revoked license, speeding, and resisting a public officer, the suspect is being charged with first-degree burglary, first-degree kidnapping, and robbery with a dangerous weapon. The officers on the scene were identified as Sean Sheffield, Joseph Bauer, and James Tyndall. All were unharmed and have been placed on administrative leave as per usual procedure following an officer-involved shooting.
Well, I do love a happy ending.
And I am guessing we're not going to see too much marching in the street over this one.
Probably not. Really, I think about the worst I could say about this is that the officers maybe need to practice their shooting simply because, well, the suspect lived.
Did it stop him from hurting the pregnant lady?
Well, absolutely.
Right, so I guess we have to chalk it up as a win, and I don't want to sound too bloodthirsty because I really wouldn't mind if he'd taken a long dirt nap neither, but, well, you know, we take what we can get, right?
Yeah. So what kind of person was shot and then subsequently received medical attention, probably at the taxpayer's expense?
Driver's license revoked, misdemeanor, class 3. Second degree trespass, misdemeanor, class 3. 2 counts larceny, misdemeanor, class 1. 2 counts larceny over 1,000, felon, class H. Obtain property by false pretense, cheat services, felon, class H. And common law robbery, felon, class G.
Yeah, this guy's escalating. Maybe being shot will make him realize there are easier ways to make money. Do you think?
No, I don't expect that he's going to learn anything of it. I am simply hoping that the judge learns that it's time for him to take a long, long, long vacation at the Iron Bar Motel.
Agreed.
Assuming he doesn't die.
And what a tragedy that would be.
Baron is on assignment and will return soon.
You're going to hear us talk about this in the show for the next couple months. We're taking a survey of our listeners, and we'd like you to participate. It will help us learn more about you, no matter how long you've been a listener or how frequently you listen to this show. So please take a few minutes and visit our website at gunblogvarietycast.com. You'll find the listener survey link at the top of the right sidebar. It's also in the show notes right at the top, and you can complete the survey anonymously. Thanks.
Miguel is not on assignment this week. He wants everyone to know that he's, quote, playing mad scientist with things nature never intended to be played with. Ha 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 ha! End quote.
Hi, this is Gail, the Predator, from the Pro Arms Podcast, reminding you that this podcast is a member of the Self Defense Radio Network. Check out the other podcast. It's at selfdefenseradio.net.
The main topic, the SHARE Act.
All right, Sean, so I am going to fall on the grenade here and pick up the idiot ball because, well, I'm going to admit I'm not as well informed about this topic as you are, so I'm going to be asking all the dumb questions here. So, SHARE Act, that's in all caps. That means it's an acronym for something.
The SHARE Act stands for Sportsman's Heritage and Enhanced Recreation Opportunities Act. Originally, it was a purely hunting bill. Every once in a while, you'll see the Sportsman's Acts that go through the federal government. And many, many years ago, it was like, oh, I believe in the Second Amendment. Look at all these hunting things I did. A lot of what the SHARE Act has to do with is hunting stuff. And if you look through it, there's plenty of things in there that are hunting specific. I do hunt, but we should not mistake me for a hunter. So a lot of it kind of goes over my head. I don't know exactly what they're going with. So what I've done is I've pulled out a couple of sections. They're called titles. I've pulled out Title 2, Title 3, Title 11, Title 15, and Title 16. So you see there's lots and lots and lots of stuff in there. Each one of those deals with a specific thing. Now, everybody knows that the Hearing Protection Act has been rolled into SHARE, or they know that it's been rolled into some sort of act. This is the one that's in. But there's lots of other interesting things in there, and I thought we should talk about all of them because some of them aren't getting the attention from the anti-gunners that they truly deserve. And the reason for that is, I think, because the anti-gunners are just as dumb as we think they are. They don't get the implications. You guys, on the other hand, are totally going to get this and going to love it. This bill is a must pass. This bill is going to have a lot of really cool stuff in it that is going to do a lot for us in the future. Not just suppressor legalization, but some really neat stuff. So let's start with Title II, Target Practice and Marksmanship Training Support Act. Aaron, do you know what the Pittman-Robertson Act is?
Actually, I don't, and I was about to ask what that is.
Oh, in fact, I guarantee you, you know all about Pittman-Robertson. You just don't know you know. There's a tax on firearms, isn't there?
Oh, yeah.
No, I'm not talking like just your sales tax. I'm talking like the straight up, there's a tax on firearms. If you buy a rifle or a shotgun, it's a certain level. If you buy a pistol, it's a little bit less. And the reason for that is that money since, I guess, the 30s? Is money that's being set aside, it's taxed to a specific location to use for sportsman stuff. Typically, it's paying for like habitat stuff. So like the duck guys will get some of this money and they'll work on making the duck, I don't know, I don't hunt ducks, so I don't know too much about it, but they can do things and enhance the duck hunting opportunities in a particular area. You see a lot of that with deer management. A lot of that Pittman-Robertson money is a lot of it. Especially as many guns as we've been buying in the last 10, 20 years, that Pittman-Robertson money is huge. And they take that money and they do things to make, you know, more hunting opportunities for everybody. But a lot of that money doesn't come from people who have anything to do with hunting. And one of the things that they changed a while back, and I think that was probably 4, 5, 6 years ago, I'm not really entirely certain when, but they started taking some of that money and channeling it into building ranges to practice on, which makes sense, right?
Yeah.
We've got a fantastic range. I want to say it's kind of sort of between Charlotte and Asheville. I don't recall exactly, but it's basically a Pittman-Robertson range, and it's fantastic. It's beautiful because, you know, like, what do you expect out of an outdoor state park land range, right? A berm, a broke down old bench, and idiots shooting bottles, right? Right. That's what we expect when we think of public range. That's not owned by somebody, like, you know, not a public access range, but like a range that the county does or this, you know, state does. They usually are just terrible.
Yeah. I mean, if you're lucky, maybe you'll have something over your head in case it rains.
Oh, if you were lucky. And this thing is like the Taj Mahal of ranges for like outdoor. Nobody's out there monitoring you. Nobody's like holding your hand while you shoot. I mean, it's like literally like an open range and it's beautiful. Well, they're making some changes in how the rules on that Pittman-Robertson money is used to maintain the ranges. I don't know the ins and outs of it. I do know, though, that that money being used for ranges is huge, given that there's so many places you just can't build a range anymore. You try to build a firing range, like an outdoor shooting range, in Wake County, North Carolina, forget it. They'll lock you away just for, they'll assume you're insane because why would you even try to do that? We have an indoor range in Wake County that's 100 yards long for everything up to, but not including a 50 cal, because there were people who were afraid that we're going to build this range for the cops and for the general public. Well, what if the bullets get out? They're like, screw it. We'll put a roof on it. How about that? So we literally have like this amazing indoor range because people were afraid that there would be an outdoor range that the county was running. That's the insanity we run into. People don't want to live near a range. I want to live close enough to a range that I don't have to drive far to get to it. May not want to live right next door to it, but I mean, seriously, there's got to be places to practice. And that was one of the Chicago cases. Like, of course there has to be shooting ranges available to people to practice. You know, you don't have a right to own a firearm if you don't have a right to actually learn how to use the thing.
Right, but Chicago was zoning them out of existence.
Pretty much, and that's what they like to do. If they can't zone them out, they'll use the sound requirements. Oh, that's too loud. It's, you know, well, you know, you can't be running around playing your music really loud, so why can we let you shoot a gun? So it's a giant hassle. So Pittman Robertson money, I don't know the specifics of it. I just wanted to mention it because it's a big deal for us. And we may not think of that Pittman Robertson money, and we may not think of how they're doing things, but there's some big changes. And if you're the sort of person who's involved in range management and land use stuff in your area, you might want to look into how that money's being spent in your area. You might find a funding source that can help your county get a better range for you. The next one is Title III, the Recreational Lands Self-Defense Act. Now, a couple years ago in the Obama administration, it was opened up into national parks and national forests for you to carry a handgun.
Well, yeah, but I think the main reason that was signed was because it was bundled to some sort of credit card bill that more or less had to pass.
Right, and I'm not giving Obama any credit for this, no matter what all the anti-gunners say. Oh, he expanded more than he took. Yeah, we knew what he would have done if he could have. That's not the point. The point is that federal lands that were long banned for concealed handgun permits, no matter what state they were in, you could go into. Well, the problem is the one sort of holdout left is the Army Corps of Engineers. I know a lot of people are thinking, well, Army Corps of Engineers, why do we care what the Army Corps of Engineers have to say? Well, here in Raleigh, there's a lake called Falls Lake. Army Corps of Engineers built this lake specifically to provide water for the Raleigh area. They impounded a whole big giant lake. All that water is then available for us to turn into drinking water. In the meantime, it's a big giant freaking lake. It's 28 miles long, 12,000 acre reservoir, 300 campsites, and 175 miles of shoreline, and you can't carry a gun in any of it because it's owned and operated by the Army Corps of Engineers. The park itself around it with the campsites, the state runs it. So it's a state camp, it's a state park, but it's Army Corps of Engineers land, and your CHP is not valid. So with this Recreational Land Self-Defense Act, Title III, it's going to tell the Army that they cannot say you can't carry a handgun there. So basically what it means is it becomes, for the purposes of a concealed handgun permit, part of the state that the land is in. So if you can carry in that state, you can carry in that park.
Good.
That's a great deal. I love it. Falls Lake is really nice. I just don't like going there. Then there's Title 11, Interstate Transportation of Firearms or Ammunition. Aaron, if you get in your car and drive from Florida to North Carolina with anything, bazookas included, nobody cares, right?
Well, yes, but that's because I live in free America, and so do you.
Right, well, and so do I, and every state in between you and me is free America. Let's say that Handgun Radio, which is in Maine, was hosting a little blogger get-together, and they said, Aaron, we want you to come out, take your little handgun, put it in a box, and drive it across the unfree states of New Jersey, New York, Massachusetts, Connecticut, wherever you had to go through until you get to Maine. And in Maine, you'd be fine because Maine is a constitutional carry state. You could totally carry up here. Legally, you're allowed to do that because the Firearms Owners Protection Act says that that's legal.
Well, FOPA says that, sure, but there's a difference between theory and practice. There's a great example of, what was it, up in Baltimore, I think, where someone from Florida was driving and they were pulled over and the cop ran their plates and somehow they were flagged as being gun owners. And so he was just absolutely convinced there was a gun in the car and was making a whole big deal about how they were armed and just general foolishness.
Right. I remember that one. The guy was coming through. It was like a man and a woman, I think. And they were going back to Florida from wherever it was they came from up north. And they were driving through Baltimore. They go through the Bay Bridge Tunnel or whatever, one of the tunnels there, and get pulled over. And because CHPs are so often attached to your driver's license, out-of-state police can sometimes tell, oh, they have a concealed handgun permit. Where's your gun? Where's your gun? Where's your gun? Well, you know what? If you're not carrying it, it's not legally concealed. If it's in a box in your trunk, it's totally legal under Firearms Owners Protection Act. The people who fly in and out of like New York, like if you have to make a connection through New York, or if you fly into New York and you drive out of there, you're still traveling. You should fall under the Firearms Owners Protection Act. But if you drive to LaGuardia Airport, if you drive to New York Airport, to Newark Airport, whatever airport in that area, and you present your firearm, they're going to arrest you because you're in possession of a firearm without a license. Well, you're traveling. Firearms Owners Protection Act says that you can do all that. The problem is you can beat the rap, but you can't beat the ride.
Mm-hmm.
So they're going to arrest you. They're going to process you. They're going to take your gun away from you. They're going to do thousands of dollars worth of damage to your financial situation while you try to prove that it's okay for you to do what you did. And then they're going to offer you a plea bargain to something misdemeanor. And it's cheaper and easier for you to plead to the misdemeanor, pay the fine, lose the gun, and never, ever, ever come back to their state again, which is the whole point. Well, this Title 11, Interstate Transport of Firearms and Ammunition, what it's going to do is it says very clearly, number one, you have to have probable cause that they're not following the rules. Number two, if you arrest them and they are acquitted, you have to pay reasonable attorney's fees. And number three, anybody who is deprived of their rights under the law by your actions, which were against this rule here, they get to sue you for punitive damages.
This actually sounds familiar. I recall when we talked about the National Concealed Carry Reciprocity Bill, however many months ago, and one of the elements in it was the preemption with teeth. And I wonder if this got rolled into the SHARE Act as well.
I don't know. That was a slightly different provision. And I imagine that part's going to have to be in Concealed Carry Reciprocity as well, because it's a different act. It's, you know, you're not just carrying locked in a box, you're carrying on your person. So it's a different series of rules. So it needs to be in there for both of them. But yeah, basically it's the same thing. It's like, look, we told you it was against the law back in Firearms Owners Protection Act, and you kept doing it. So now what we're going to do is we're going to give people a way to sue you so that you think twice about it, because clearly you don't care. You're just going to violate the law. So we're going to hook you up with some punitive damages. And we know that governments don't care until they lose money, right?
Well, actually, not even necessarily then. I've lost track of how many times Chicago has had to write a check to the NRA, ILA, and or the Second Amendment Foundation.
Seriously, yeah. But at least at that point, they know that they're not hurting me as much as I'm going to get out of the deal. Somebody takes my gun and I plead to a misdemeanor. I lose $500 worth of gun. I lose $500,000, $2,000 in fines. I lose days and days of my life dealing with their BS. I get locked up in jail. I can never get that back. But if I can then turn around and sue them, get all of that back, then it's a lot easier to convince a lawyer to come in and take the case. There'll be sharks all over the place saying, ooh, let me take this case. I'm going to take him for a lot of money. Reasonable attorney's fees. I wonder how far that stretches.
I want some of that sweet, sweet City Hall money.
That's right. And you know, at a certain point, people stop pulling crap like that. I have a friend who told me the story of somebody who had a machine gun that he was transporting through Chicago. Totally illegal in that state, but it was legal to transport because the federal laws involved say that it's okay to transport. Well, they seized the firearm from the guy. They tried to do a bunch of stuff to him. He sued them and sued them for so much money that now that if they even think maybe it's legal, they'll leave you alone. Like even Chicago learns. So I don't know the ins and outs of that story, but yeah, basically you hit them and hurt them pretty good, they'll stop. Because the reality of all they're trying to do is make it so miserable that you'll stay away. You'll leave your gun at home. Because what rational person is going to put themselves in that position when the easiest thing to do is just disarm and hope that nothing bad happens?
or simply not visit their state, which is what I do.
That's a win-win for them. Like, you won't show up and they don't have to deal with you. So the next one is Title 15. This is the one that everyone's hearing about, and this is the one that you're seeing over and over and over again, the anti-gun groups sending out email after email after email about redneck ninja death squads with silencers murdering people on the streets.
Yeah, Larry Correa had a hilarious fisk about that. Oh my goodness.
Yes.
Well, we've got a dead body here and pumped full of lead, and we've got shell casings, but And witnesses, but no one heard anything, so I guess we're done for the day. Hail Trump.
Yeah, hail Trump. Yeah, that was a great one. I love that. So everybody knows about the Hearing Protection Act. All it's going to do is going to make silencers transfer the same way you transfer a firearm, so 4473. Now, we can argue about how dumb it is that I have to fill out paperwork and say, yes, sir, may I please, to get what is essentially a tube with some baffles in it. But it's better than the 9-month to 1 year $200 tax stamp garbage that I went through for my silencer.
Incremental change. You know, we get this, then maybe we can move towards them not actually being treated like firearms at all.
The next thing is states can't impose a special tax. So the $200 tax stamp that you're paying now, the state of, you know, say, who allows them but doesn't really like them, you know, Maryland or New York, I don't know who will let you have them. They can't say, oh, well, you know, they're no longer banned by federal. You know, they're not really banned. They're just taxed. I know. We'll put $1,000 tax on it. We'll charge them $1 million. This thing says you can't do that. So, ha, no using your tax power to destroy. And another cool thing is all NFA registration records must be destroyed within 365 days of passage of the law. So, that means the record that I have a silencer is now, you know, through the shredder. Yay. I'll keep the actual stamp as a curiosity, but no more records. And if I want to sell it to somebody, all I have to do is treat it like a regular firearm.
I'm a little cynical that the government will actually give up paperwork.
You know, I'm kind of worried too, but I am heartened by what happened in Durham when Durham got rid of its pistol registry. We have video, actual, like, long form, like, hours of video of them feeding the cards into the shredder.
Nice.
It was a beautiful thing. Brought a tear to my eye. 5 stars, 2 thumbs up. So the Hearing Protection Act, everybody's hearing about that, you know, no pun intended, but here's the actual coolest part of the entire bill is Title 16, Lawful Purpose and Self-Defense. The Lawful Purpose and Self-Defense Act, Title 16 of this bill, rifle ammo may not be reclassified as armor-piercing just because it can be used in a pistol. Remember we went through all of that?
Oh, yeah, I remember. And that was another way that the various forms of the government try to restrict handgun use or firearm use, because if they can't get you zoned out because of noise, they'll make it environmental. You can't use lead because it'll hurt the wildlife. Okay, well, I'll use steel. No, steel is armor piercing. Well, then what do? We can't shoot anything then. That's the point.
That's exactly what they were doing. And it means that all that ammo that we couldn't get, all that Russian, was it 5.56 by whatever they use for the AK-74s, all that ammo can start coming back in the United States. The second thing that I saw looking through it, maybe more than just three, but the second of the three that I saw in there was it ends using that sporting use to ban importation of firearms. Now, do you have any firearms that are mostly made in a foreign country that are would be considered assault weapons by the government? You don't have like an AK or something like that.
I don't have an AK. I have an SKS, and I don't know if that qualifies or not.
No, the SKS, I think, is one of the ones that doesn't really qualify under this. I don't know the ins and outs of it. But let's say you buy yourself an AK from Russia. They have to take it to pieces. I think they have to destroy some of the parts of it, ship it to the United States. It has to be assembled in the United States. And then it has to have a certain number of American-made parts in order to qualify as an American-made weapon.
Right. Section 922R.
Yeah. They can't just build it in Russia at the Izhmash facility or whatever they call that place, put it in a box, and ship it to you, which would probably be more efficient because they know how to build the rifle. and it causes it to be more expensive. And that's the point. There's a lot of stuff that 922R makes difficult to come by. So in some ways, it's helpful because it gets some of these businesses to come to the United States, because they do have like a Russian AK factory here in, I think it's in Pittsburgh. I don't know, someplace that you would never really expect. But they decided to start building rifles here in the United States because it was easier than dealing with the stupid importation requirements. But why shouldn't we be able to import a gun from anywhere in the world and buy it? So this whole sporting use crap gets thrown out the window. Instead of it must be only usable for sporting use, it just has to have a sporting use. And you know what? Competition is sport. So there you go. And the third thing, which is kind of weird but important, is protection of shotguns, shotgun shells, and large caliber rifles from being classified as destructive devices. Do you know what destructive devices, what the definition is?
It's one of these, past a certain caliber or whatever, it's big and it's scary and it's not a gun, it's a destructive device.
Right. It's 50 caliber. So the largest rifle is 50 caliber, or it's the largest bore diameter is half an inch, basically. And anything larger than half an inch that isn't for sporting use only is classified as a destructive device. So if you want to have a 60 caliber rifle or a 755 JDD or whatever the heck that dinosaur killer thing the guy was building, you have to prove somehow that this is for sporting purposes only. This isn't a destructive device. And you know that a 12 gauge shotgun is bigger than half an inch.
Yeah, 12 gauge is something like 73 caliber. Although I was under the impression that shotguns had a specifically carved out by name exemption.
If it's a sporting use. So there are a lot of things. There are guns like the Street Sweeper was banned because it didn't have a sporting use. It was a self-defense shotgun. It was an anti-personnel weapon. It wasn't a sporting use gun. So it's not really banned because it's a semi-auto shotgun. It's banned because it's a destructive device.
Okay.
As far as I remember, at least. So basically what it says is if there's a sporting purpose for it, you can have it. So let's say somebody built a 12-gauge semi-auto shotgun in Russia. They can ban it for being a not sporting use foreign firearm, number one, or they can classify it. Well, we can't do that. So, all right, we'll change it. We'll call it a destructive device and ban it on that. Well, guess what? No, you can't. This sporting use thing right here, this is one of the things is you can really tell that the people who run the anti-gun groups really honestly have no idea how this works. If they knew how this works, they would be far less worried about the Hearing Protection Act than they were about the Lawful Purpose and Self-Defense Act. Because the Lawful Purpose and Self-Defense Act kind of yanks the rug out from under a whole lot of dumb anti-gun rules that we deal with right now. If you eliminate the sporting use as a reason to ban a weapon from being either made or imported, then basically we can now get whatever we want from overseas. And there's not a single thing that anti-gunners can do about it. If they knew what they were looking at, then they would look at this with absolute horror. But they don't. They don't have a clue. All they know is silencers are scary, so let's freak out about that. And honestly, I don't think they have a hope in hell of stopping this bill. The only thing that they're doing is using it as a way to raise money. And I hope they go broke, personally.
Well, yeah, what was it Weird said however many sessions ago? Something like how it seems like the only purpose of the anti-gun groups is to evoke fear in order to raise money for themselves.
Pretty much. I really think that that's the majority of what they're doing is just let's raise money to keep our phony baloney jobs. That's really all they do.
Yeah.
So the important thing to do here is get on the horn with your Congress critter and say you want the SHARE Act passed. It's really important that this pass. This is one of two things that we can get through the Congress that will make a huge difference in our lives. This one is a lot stealthier than the much more high-profile concealed handgun reciprocity. This is going to make some huge changes. And like I said, the anti-gunners really don't even know what's about to hit them. It's not about silencers. That lawful purpose and self-defense thing, that's going to kill them.
So, don't let any anti-gunner listen to this podcast. We don't want them to know what's going on. Shh.
Oh, they could tell each other and they still wouldn't understand. These guys are dumb. So go ahead and tell them. You'll just confuse them. It's not like they've cared about the facts up till now.
Tiffany is on assignment and will return soon.
Cerakote is a polymer ceramic composite coating that can be applied to metals, plastics, polymers, and wood. It's also what will take your plain Jane firearm from basic to full custom. Whether you want a handgun coated in just a single color, your hunting rifle camouflaged for your specific environment, or your competition pistol sprayed in purple, white, and black Carolina Cryptic, you want Carolina Ceramic Coating to do the job. Bud and his team of skilled technicians will carefully disassemble and clean your firearm, professionally apply the Cerakote in your choice of colors and patterns, and return your firearm to you in perfect working order. And they also do auto engine parts. When I wanted my competition handgun Cerakoted, I trusted Carolina Ceramic Coating, and you should too. Check out their work on Instagram. Search at CerakoteNC, that's at CERAKOTENC, or go to CarolinaCeramicCoating.com. And now it's time for Blue Collar Prepping with that bratty kid sister of the gun blogosphere, Erin Paulette.
Come on, every pony! It's time for Blue Collar Prepping with Erin Paulette!
As you know, most of Florida was without power for up to a week after Irma. While it does suck to be away from the internet and entertainment, the biggest complaint I've seen has been from people who lost their air conditioning. And this makes sense. Florida is a hot, humid place, and it sucks to be without AC. As Miguel said some weeks ago, during most of the year, we Floridians essentially live in bubbles of air conditioning. But sometimes the power goes out, and we're forced to find unplugged ways to cool off. Here are some tips and tricks that ought to help. Use water to cool off. If you have water pressure, then cool showers will rinse off the sticky sweat and lower your skin temperature. Wet hair is also the gift that keeps giving, because the longer it stays damp, the cooler your head feels. You can also sleep under a damp sheet. Don't go overboard with this. Just get a spare cotton sheet and run it under the faucet, then wring it out and spread it over you before you sleep. If you end up feeling too cold or don't like the feeling of wet cotton on top of you, put a towel between you and the sheet. If you live in a multi-story building, sleep as close to the ground as possible. This is because hot air rises, but cool air sinks. Now's a great time to break out those air mattresses. Speaking of sleeping, nap during the hottest parts of the day. If you're hot, you won't feel like doing anything, and sleep is an excellent way to escape discomfort. So endure the afternoon heat by sleeping through it. The siesta, or post-lunch nap, is popular in Spain and Latin America for this very reason. If you're having difficulty sleeping during the day because of the amount of light in your room, invest in some blackout curtains for the house. These are great for a variety of reasons. Not only do they block the light so you can sleep, they also prevent the house from warming up through the windows. What's more, if you have a generator in your house and you don't want the neighborhood to know that you have power, these curtains prevent light from leaking out at night. I have found that I can endure higher temperatures and humidity if I can just get some air blowing on my face. Portable fans and a supply of batteries will go a long way towards personal comfort. Turn one on when you feel hot and carry it with you when you change rooms, because you don't need to cool off the whole room, just a few feet around you. I recommend the O2 Cool 5-inch portable fan. It requires 2D cell batteries and only costs $5 with free shipping on Amazon. Finally, don't forget about your pets. Cats and dogs get hot too. My mother bought a pair of pressure-activated cooling gel pads for our dogs, and let me tell you, they work really well. I know this because one of our dogs refused to lie on her cooling pad. I don't know why, she's just silly that way. And so Mom put that pad on her own bed and slept on it, which made her life more comfortable. When I came back home, Mom gave that cooling pad to me because I'm always hot in this house, and it's on the back of my chair in the living room. Comfy.
Weird is back again with one more show of the Brady Campaign's former president, Dan Gross, in This Week in Anti-Gun Nuttery.
For those just tuning in, Dan Gross was hired as the president of the Brady Campaign because Paul Helmke's nominal affiliation with the Republican Party turned from being an asset to a liability. But now Dan has done nothing but run Brady into the rocks, and the Brady Board of Directors has decided they need female power. So Dan is out and two female lawyers are in. So I'm paying tribute to the man who took what was once the greatest threat to the Second Amendment in America and turned it into a joke. Last week, I showed how willing he was to lie to sell a failed agenda. I've got more for this week.
10 years ago, 42% of the American public believed that a gun, incorrectly, makes your home safer. Today, that number is 63%.
Incorrectly? Gun ownership is up. Violent crime is down. Maybe those facts don't prove that guns make us safer, but they sure disprove the jive Dan is trying to sell.
Corporate gun lobby has spent billions of dollars blocking the CDC from doing research into the public health epidemic of gun violence.
Because gun violence is neither an epidemic, nor does it have anything to do with epidemiology.
Blocking pediatricians from talking to parents about the dangers of guns in the home.
And where do they teach about firearms law and gun safety in medical school? I don't ask a firearms instructor to look at this strange skin rash I have any more than I'd ask my doctor about gun facts. Especially when much of the doctor's gun education was from the corporate anti-gun lobby.
Blocking smart gun technology and other technology that would prevent kids from firing parents' guns.
Blatant lie. The NRA has done nothing to block smart guns, or even oppose their development. Instead, they have fought against anti-gun laws that would make traditional firearms illegal and mandate that all guns sold be smart. Oh, and smart guns aren't smart. Just listen to my interview with Joe Huffman on the subject back in episode 26.
They view the truth as a threat to their bottom line.
Says the man who closes the comment sections on his YouTube channel and only speaks to friendly crowds. Is this psychological projection or blatant lying? Or both?
For my organization, for the Brady campaign, that dream is reflected in the bold goal to cut the number of gun deaths in the U.S. in half by 2025.
Bold indeed. Well, gun deaths have been dropping. At this point, they're almost as low as the number of Brady campaign victories. Really bold when you think about how at the time of this speech, Gross had brought nothing but failure to the Brady campaign, and now is out on his rear.
And I'm here to say that for the movement to end gun violence in America, that moment is here.
Nope. This was said over a year ago, and nothing has happened. Well, no, that's not true. Their endorsed candidates have lost major elections, and their endorsed ballot initiatives went down in flame. Further, those candidates and ballot initiatives were all propped up by the money of Daddy Bloomberg, because the Brady campaign itself is broke.
Enough of the mass shootings in malls and movie theaters and churches and schools.
All gun-free zones, and the shooters knew that.
Enough of the daily terror of gun violence that in homes and streets that's claiming the lives of women and young black men in staggering proportions.
He's talking about gang violence here. What on earth is the Brady campaign going to do about that? It's not like criminals get their guns from shops or gun shows.
It's enough of easy access to guns by the people that we all agree shouldn't have them.
How is it being a federal felony and likely a state felony for a prohibited person to possess a firearm easy access? And if that is considered easy access, it would seem the less serious laws the anti-gun groups have proposed wouldn't hinder that at all.
And enough of a small group of craven politicians putting the interests of the corporate gun lobby ahead of the people that they have been elected to represent. Enough.
Well, except politicians have been successfully shooting down anti-gun laws. Seems the minority of politicians are the ones who are against the Second Amendment. And those politicians are indeed being propped up by a corporate lobby. And those corporations are owned by Michael Bloomberg.
Kim Kardashian has made an unsolicited, passionate appeal to her 35 million Twitter followers for expanded background checks.
And Kim has a team of armed bodyguards. So yeah, that went really far.
We're still outfunded, yes, by the corporate gun lobby.
And by the corporate anti-gun lobby. Michael Bloomberg often outspends pro-gun groups when he sets his sights on an election or a ballot initiative. He outspends the pro-gun groups, and he loses.
We're smarter, and we're scrappier, and we have the truth on our side.
No, you're liars. You're idiots for thinking we'll buy your lies. And you're getting the losses you deserve. So farewell to Dan Gross. I'm going to miss your painfully easy audio fisks. But something tells me your replacements will make you look like a genius. So stay tuned for more lies and bad faith arguments.
In addition to appearing here, Weird is a regular host on The Squirrel Report and blogs at weirdworld.com. That's W-E-E-R-D world.com.
Plug of the week, Magic Carpet Cruise Control.
You know, I've got that song from Aladdin running through my head. I will spare you my attempts to sing it. But when we were talking before the podcast, you were just enthusing about your new car and the really cool cruise control it had. You went on for at least 10 minutes about it, and so this is quite obviously our plug of the week here. So Sean, tell us why the Magic Carpet Cruise Control is just the ne plus ultra of car accessories.
Ooh, fancy words there. I got the new 2018 Toyota. It's a Camry Hybrid. It's the same car I had before. I had the 2016. Now I have a 2018 Camry Hybrid. The company decides what they're going to give you, and they give it to you. You don't get any choice in it. I've driven a Ford, I don't know what the heck that was, a Malibu from Chevy. I'd had Impalas before. For some reason, they decided in 2016, we're going to go with a hybrid car. And I drug my feet. I don't want a hybrid. I don't want a Toyota Camry Hybrid. They give it to me, and I'm like, this is a really great car. I drove it for like 89,000 miles, and I traded it in for the new company car, which is a 2018 Camry Hybrid. And I spent the last 6 months saying, I hope they don't give me that Malibu back. I want another Camry. Well, they did. The 2016's killer app for me was the fact that I didn't have to take my keys out of my pocket. I just walked up to the door. You know, I just pulled the door open, the door unlocked, and it let me in. You saw how that worked, right?
Yeah.
It's pretty cool, huh?
It is pretty cool. It's one of those things that you don't really think about until you have it, and then you become so instantly spoiled by it, you can't imagine living without it.
Exactly. Well, this year's killer app is the Radar Cruise Control. I set the cruise to the speed that I want to drive. It won't exceed that speed. And I drive down the highway or the byways or whatever roads I happen to be on. It has to be over like 30 miles an hour. And I set in the dash the distance that I want between me and the car in front of me. And let's say I'm driving down the road, and for some reason, the person who is in front of me disagrees with me about the speed which is appropriate on that road.
Which happens all the freaking time.
Right, and totally makes him an idiot because I am absolutely right about the speed we should be driving. Just saying. So Mr. Idiot needs to drive slower, which means I have to turn off the cruise control, and then I have to drive and match his speed. And the one thing cruise control has taught me is that people cannot maintain a speed in the car. They just can't do it. It's physically impossible for people to maintain a steady speed. I don't know why, they just can't do it. So now I'm behind the guy seething, getting madder, like, what is the matter with this person? Why is he such an idiot? Who gave him a driver's license? Did he get it out of a Cracker Jack box? Does his mom know that she gave birth to a complete and total moron?
Tell us how you really feel.
You know, the standard stuff. You go through this every day. Well, instead, my brand new Toyota says, well, I'll just maintain the speed behind him and I'll slow down and I'll just match him. And if he speeds up, I'll speed up. And if he slows down, I'll slow down a little more. If he slows down a lot, I'll put on the brakes. If he comes to a red light and stops, I will drive up to him and I will stop right behind him. No input from my feet required.
You don't even have to touch the brake?
I don't have to touch the brake, no.
Awesome.
It will stop the car, like a car, like, you know how you got taught when you were just learning how to drive tires and street? You should be able to see over your hood and see not only the guy's tires, but the street between you and those tires.
Right.
Literally, it's exactly where it parks you. Boom, tires and street. Gives you enough so that you can crank your wheels and drive around him if his car breaks down for some reason. I drove like 40 miles on the highway yesterday. I got onto the highway. I set the cruise control to 75, which is 5 over the speed limit. I drove all the way up 64. I drove up 540. I just steered, stayed between the lines. And if they drove slow, the car slowed down. We literally went through stop and go traffic on the freeway because there was car accidents and stuff on the side. And you know how everybody has to turn their head and look. Oh, what's going on over there? Maybe I'm going to see some blood. Nosy people. And, you know, bumper to bumper, stop and go, and the car would stop. Now, it won't start again once it comes to a complete stop. You have to tap the gas to let it know, okay, it's okay, go ahead and you can go now. And shoop, it follows the guy behind him, and if he takes off and goes up to 80 miles an hour, ooh, that 75 is fast enough, and the car will stop at that. But if he slows down again, it slows down too. And all of that stress and annoyance and just, you're making me work here to stay behind me, you toolhead, it goes away because the computer handles all that for you. All you got to do is stay between the lines and pay attention to what you're doing. It is freaking awesome. If you have the option of getting one of these things, oh my goodness, it's awesome. I cannot wait to the time I have to take a long drive someplace. And long drive for me, you know, drive 400 or 500 miles. Because I'm going to get on the highway and I'm just going to set the cruise control to 5 over and I'm not going to touch my brake pedal or my gas pedal for like 400 miles. It's awesome.
Yeah, and as someone who very recently drove from Florida to North Carolina to Tennessee, back to Florida, and who uses cruise control a lot, there were so many times where I had to disengage it or tap the brake just because people in the middle or right-hand lanes just were not going the speed limit.
Ugh.
So, yeah, I can imagine how this is very, very useful. I could quickly become addicted to that.
Well, you know, all you got to do is buy a brand new Camry. They're like, what? I don't know. I didn't look at the sticker, but they're like $26,000. You got that in the bank, right?
Man, I have that in petty cash.
Sure. Don't we all?
Let me go dig around in the sofa.
That's exactly where I keep that much money. We got a few things to do before I go and light my cigar with a $100 bill. Last reminder, join GBVC Radio Group on Facebook. Next week, a couple of days after you hear this, I'm going to choose the winner of the Filster Flat Pack, the cat tourniquet, and a little pouch that I guess if you don't use the Filster, you can use that, or you can use the pouch for something else. I'm going to randomly select somebody from GBVC Facebook group, and you will get it. So join GBVC Radio Group on Facebook. Well, that's our show for the week. Remember that Gunblog Varietycast Radio is a member of the Self-Defense Radio Network.
Find the show notes at gunblogvarietycast.com/episode163.
Thank you for listening to this episode of the Gunblog Varietycast. Music courtesy of Rob Allen at blog.roballen.com. You can subscribe to this podcast on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, and Google Play Music. This podcast is made possible by the Firearms Policy Coalition and by contributions from listeners like you. This is a URS production.